Good morning, church. Happy New Year. I haven't seen you guys since last year, right? So that's always like the joke that we kind of do. But you know, I just want to say that this is a huge blessing, and I'm humbled to be here to share the word of God with you all today. So without further ado, let's go ahead and bow our heads in prayer and begin. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for gathering us all here this morning through the snow, through whatever trials that we face this morning, scraping the car and everything. God, we are so happy to be able to gather here together. And we thank you for 2021. And as we go into 2022, would you help us to dive into a deeper love of you as we search your scriptures in your word. And we thank you, and I lift this all up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. So my wife, Kayla, and I, we are so blessed and so thankful because we've received such a warm welcome from the church, and we are so excited to know each and every one better. And speaking of knowing, something that you should know about my wife and I is that we are big MCU Marvel Cinematic Universe fans. So much so that we actually named our little puppy Odin, so Thor's dad. That's what we named him. It was kind of cute. But with that being said, we are the people to watch the movies in chronological order. Those who stay at the end of the movie to watch the end credits, plural. And also, people to watch videos of dissections of what happened in the movie. And with that being said, we are big, big, big people excited about this world premiere of Spider-Man No Way Home. And I'm not going to spoil anything, but you should go watch it. But in the beginning of the story of Spider-Man, Peter Parker is on a field trip, and he gets bitten by a genetically modified spider. And what happens is he starts to gain these powers. He's able to climb walls, shoot webs, and have spidey senses. And as he's trying to figure out and hone in on his powers that he's received, he actually gets himself in a little bit of trouble. And so Uncle Ben one morning drops him off at the library. And this is where the famous saying comes from. So if you guys know it, say it with me. With great power comes great responsibility. And that is going to be the sermon title for today, because little did Uncle Ben and Peter know that this was going to be the last conversation that they will ever have with one another. And so as Peter Parker continues on without Uncle Ben, he hones in on his skills and his power, and he has an option. He has the option to use his powers for himself, or he can use his powers to benefit other people. And I'm sharing this story with you today because in our passage, we will be looking at Timothy's entrustment and responsibility to preach the word of God. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn with me there to 2 Timothy 4, 1 through 5. So this is the second letter to Timothy, written by the Apostle Paul, who is currently in jail at this time in Rome. And this isn't the first time that he's actually in jail, but this time it's different. He's actually waiting days, hours even, to be martyred for his faith. Paul, who is considered to be the most important person after the death of Jesus, who went on 3 to 4 possible missionary journeys, raising up leaders, building churches, who wrote 13 of the New Testament books, the author of many of our favorite Bible verses, is writing his last words to his beloved Timothy, who he mentored. What would you say to your beloved ones? Your dad, mom, brother, sister, mother, spouse, child, if you only had a couple hours to live? And maybe you've been on the receiving end of someone nearing the last words of his life or her life. Do you still remember those words? So my first point is this: steward the word of God, verse 1 and 2. It reads, I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom. Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. So in this first verse, we come across the phrase, I charge you in the presence of Christ and God. This was a solemn charge, a serious urge or a demand, as a reminder as the weight of Timothy, the task that he is to carry. Kind of like if we carried something that was worth $2,000 compared to something that was worth $2. We're more aware of the importance of taking care of the item that is most expensive compared to the cheap one. And the charge in the presence of God in Christ Jesus is elevating the task to the highest authority possible. God, who is the creator of the heavens and the earth, as well as the one who is to judge the living and the dead, is going to judge Timothy. Timothy is going to be accountable for God for his actions, because Timothy has knowledge of God and he is to steward, manage this command to preach the word in verse 2. And above all, Paul commands Timothy to preach the word. And preaching in its original meaning is to proclaim publicly. So back in the old times, a very hard time when there wasn't any internet, when the king had a message to deliver, he couldn't tweet or update his status, so he sent a messenger to deliver his words. This messenger is also called a heralder, who was to tell of the king's message without adding to it. He would, of course, use his own voice and personality to make sure the message was heard, but the central message remained. We are heralders. We have a king with the message, news that all must hear. Okay, so what's this news? What do we preach? Well, we are heralders of the King Jesus, who preached the Bible, of course. But let me be more specific. Are we to preach that Esau sold his birthright for some stew? By all means, you know, when the time comes for it, yes. But it's in the scriptures over and over and over again that we ought to preach Christ. And in the Old Testament, if we summarize what the prophets preached, it's basically, judgment is coming, repent, and turn to God. You probably won't do it perfectly, but there's going to be someone who will come on your behalf to save you. They were pointing to Jesus. And during Jesus' early ministry, he preached the same. In Matthew, John the Baptist, a heralder for Christ, was arrested, and Jesus preached the gospel. In Matthew 4:17, it says this: from that time, Jesus began to preach, saying, repent, for the kingdom is at hand. And in the book of Mark, this same account records Jesus saying, repent, believe in the gospel. Out of all scriptures, Jesus preached this very word. Not that the other stories like Jacob or Esau aren't important, but that all of scripture are meant to point to the gospel itself. And the good news that we are to deliver as heralders, but why do we care to deliver this message? Why is this news so important that we must tell all? Because there's power in the word of God. In Romans 1:16, it says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes." And as believers, we should not be ashamed of the gospel, because the gospel is power, and power that we must preach to others and ourselves. So what do we preach? We preach Christ crucified. And why do we preach it? Because it is the power of God that saves. In Corinthians, it says, in 1 Corinthians, we preach Christ crucified, and Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. So preaching the word is not a light responsibility, but it is the one that must happen as stewards of God. Okay, so we talked about the specifics of what we should preach, but now how do we actually steward and communicate the power of the gospel? Hobby Lobby decor and Facebook statuses aren't enough. We need to actually open up the Bible for ourselves and with others. Preaching, heralding publicly, is not only meant to be for pastors on a pulpit on Sunday, but also for everyone. And John the Baptist, as mentioned, was a heralder of the word. Another example in the Bible is the woman at the well in John 4, who is in fact a heralder, because she publicly proclaimed Christ. After talking with Jesus, she finds out that he is the Messiah, and she runs back into town heralding, "Come, see a man who has told me all that I ever did. Can he be the Christ?" And because of her testimony, later on in John 4 and verse 39, it says that many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. And many more believed because of his, Jesus' words. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world." So notice that the way this woman was a steward of what Jesus revealed to her was just simply sharing her story with others. And you can do the same. And publicly proclaiming the gospel doesn't mean you go to your neighbor's neighborhood block party with a megaphone saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." But you'll find that the best way to preach the gospel is one-on-one, opening and sharing the word of God. And another example found is in the words of Luke 24, 6 through 10. And this took place right after Jesus' crucifixion. He was buried for 3 days, and the women brought spices to the tomb, but they found that the tomb was empty. And they realized again that, wow, he has risen. And he goes back, and they go back to tell the apostles. And I want us to pay attention to verse 10 here. It states that Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Mary, the mother of James, and other women with them were the ones proclaiming this truth. If he could use everyday, ordinary men and women like you and I, he can use us. If heralding the scriptures on Sunday was the extent of preaching the gospel, we're at a loss. Because it's the duty of every believer to publicly proclaim the word of God. So now that we know that we are to preach and who should preach, let's talk about when we should preach. And verse 2 says, "Be ready in season and out of season." And as some of you know, shout out to the students and youth group, I love Crocs. And the reason why I love Crocs so much is because they're versatile and they are ready for anything. So for example, if I'm getting the mail, I slip on some Crocs because they're convenient. If we're going to Splash Country right there in the summer, guess what? I'll probably have my Crocs. Because believe it or not, like real crocodiles, my shoes, my Crocs can go in and out of water just fine. And also, if I need to run after my hat that is knocked off from the aurora wind that we face, I'll flip that thing into all-wheel drive and I'm ready for action. Just like how I'm ready to face any situations with my Crocs, Paul is telling Timothy to be ready to preach in the church, outside the church, when it's busy, when it's not busy, when it's convenient or not convenient. He is to remain ready in season and out of season to preach the word regardless of the changes in circumstance. He is to preach in a manner that reproves, rebukes, and exhorts with complete patience and teaching. So in other words, to confront, to disapprove, and encourage. Now, Timothy was a young pastor in Ephesus. And Ephesus at this time was a prosperous city of commerce with buying, selling, and trading. And with that being said, people of all different religious backgrounds are coming in and out of the city all the time. And this city was known for cult worship and idol worship. So it's important that Timothy, when he was preaching, his message would reprove, rebuke, confront, and disapprove, and also to exhort and encourage those who were there. Preaching still needs to be heard by believers as well. So reprove, rebuke, and exhort can all be methods to train well. And in Proverbs 22:6, it states that if we train a child in the way that he should go, even when he is old, he will not depart from it. So in training, the goal is to assist in setting a path. If a child goes wrong by the standards of God, you correct them. And if they fall short, you patiently teach them. And if they are doing something correctly, you encourage them to keep going. And it's easy to get frustrated at first, but the later part of the verse tells us that the part of stewarding, the preaching the word, and training is sanctifying us. It's building us. Patience is necessary because we are image bearers of God. Patience is necessary because people will be against us. And patience is needed when we do not see fruit. But being patient does not mean being passive and saying, oh, God's still working on their life, you know, and just pray for them. You could actually be the change here. And like gardening, right? When you plant a seed, you can't expect for it to sprout up to look like the picture on the seed bag. It takes patience, right? We water it daily. We put it in sunlight, and as well as seeing if it has enough soil to grow, and hopeful, and we are hoping that something will sprout. Are you waiting on God to transform someone in your life? Are you being active in sowing seeds and being patient, hopeful that something will sprout? We must try and depend on God as he works. And in 1 Corinthians 1:8, it says, for the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are believing, saved, it's the power of God. Many will reject God, but it does not change our proclamation of the scriptures and its central message. So where do we find places to preach? And the answer is, it's right where you are. The people who you see on a daily basis is the mission field. Is the harvest. You have been placed in a specific community for the purpose of publicly proclaiming the good news through word and living it out. As in Matthew 28:19, the Great Commission, it commands us to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We are to go, and wherever we go, we are to make disciples. We're to make followers. We tell them the gospel. For God so loved the world that he sent his only Son, so that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. So if we're at Woodman's, if we're in the line at Harner's, we're by the Fox River, we preach the word. We tell them about the gospel. On a weekly basis, the majority of us spend more time with our coworkers and our classmates more than our family. Take that time to share the gospel. So if we're part of sports teams, extracurricular activities, if you're in elementary, middle, high school, college, if you're around people in general, we are to tell them about the gospel. And with a great task, we are to also expect a great challenge. And the second point is this: expect opposition. Verse 3 and 4. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. So the time is coming does not necessarily say that there's a prophecy, but Paul is seeing a trend here. And the trend here is that people are going to be more drawn to sin than the truth. We have the word endure here. Endure means persisting in suffering, to remain in existence, to last, to survive. And a prime example of that illustration is marathons, right? Marathon runners endure getting cramps, their legs feeling like jello, when they're out of breath, when they're dehydrated, when they're thirsty. And when that time comes, it's easy to quit and to relieve yourself from the suffering. And that is exactly what the people are doing. They're quitting and they're saying, I'm done, I've had enough. They don't desire to go through the pain to endure sound teaching or healthy teaching. And that healthy teaching is measured up to the standards of the Word of God. So it's kind of like saying, I know I should eat a healthy, nutritious salad and then opting out for hamburgers and pizza. So the diet of a youth pastor. And like having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions. And we know what is correct and not correct, but we often choose the option that is most easiest, most convenient for us. We are looking to satisfy ourselves only. We're giving up our eternity for momentary pleasures. And we can see that in the illustration of Exodus 32 in the Old Testament, where the Israelite people were in the desert. They have just received the Ten Commandments. Moses has gone up the mountain again. And they start to wait. They start to wander, and they want something that they can worship. They want something tangible, something in front of them, something that they can believe in. And so with that being said, they end up making an idol for themselves, and they start to worship it. They wandered off from the commandments of God to myths, beliefs that are not true, and it ultimately led to death. And craving tangible things to satisfy our unbelief still happens today, believe it or not. And how do we endure the thousands of notifications of new teachings, myths, entertainments? How do we endure or persist in suffering? And that is through knowing and trusting the absolute truth and wisdom found in God's Word. And I've been reading a book. It's called The Wisdom Pyramid, and the author says this: our world has become more and more our world has more and more information, but less and less wisdom. More data, less clarity, more stimulation, less synthesis, more distraction, less stillness, more pontificating, less pondering, more opinion, less research, more speaking, less listening, more to look at, less to see, more amusement, less joy. There's more, but we are less, and we all feel it. And so if you guys are aware, back in the day, there is a food pyramid, right? And the food pyramid was actually made in 1992 by the Department of Agriculture for people to understand the folly of eating French fries, soda, and candy, and the wisdom of eating grains, fruits, and veggies. The food pyramid was given as a visual guide for healthy eating habits, offering guidance of proportionate servings, formula, and a balanced diet. So if you guys remember, in this food pyramid, the more that you should consume is at the bottom, right? And then the less that you should consume is at the top. And at the top of the food pyramid is oils. And some even caution that says use sparingly. And so with today, we actually don't even follow that at all. If I can even say the more so, oils are at the very bottom, the one that we consume the most. But I want to talk about it in a spiritual sense where we're actually able to look at it. Are we actually consuming the right things? What are we feeding ourselves that dictate what we think? And I would have to argue that, you know, cell phones, laptops, electronics are at the very bottom. That's the thing that we consume ourselves with the most. And at the very top, maybe we'll pray 30 seconds a day, a minute a day, 5 minutes a day. At the very bottom, at the very core, what we should be consuming the most is the Word of God. And that's how we distinguish truth from what society tells us today. We know what real truth looks like when we spot false teachings. So anything contrary to what the Bible says is false. And again, the centrality of the Word of God is to be known and stood firmly upon. A false teaching today is the prosperity gospel. That's like saying God is so rich and he wants to give us riches, money, and blessings. This is our best life yet. But reality check. If you're in this religion, in this belief for Christ, for the money, you're not worshiping God, you're worshiping money. And Timothy 6:10 says that for the love of money is the root of all evil, and they have erred from the faith. Another teaching is, I can get into heaven by being a good person. Reality check, no one is a good person. No one is able to go to heaven on their own. Even the best person that you can think of is sinful. And in Romans 3:23-24, it says, for all have fallen short and sinned and come short of the glory of God. It is not our good works that get us to heaven, but it is by believing and trusting in Jesus that we are justified, found righteous in front of Jesus. And it is important that we look to the Word of God so that we ourselves do not stray away from false teachings and giving into myths. But with the task that is given to us and knowing that there will be opposition, Paul urges Timothy to stay strong. And that is my last point. Persevere in kingdom responsibilities. Verse 5 says, as for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do your work as an evangelist, and fulfill your ministry. The mission is to preach a holy word in a sinful world. And that's going to be hard. That's going to be difficult. There's situations that you're going to have to endure for the gospel, like not being liked by people, being outcasted from your family, being rejected. It's going to be discouraging to continue on, but we are to continue on with keeping a sober mind, a clear perspective to not being bogged down if we fail. And we will fail, but we won't be failing all the time. Because sometimes there will be successes as well. And as a follower and disciple of Christ, one of the greatest joys is leading someone to the kingdom of God. It never gets old. It's kind of like when you take the sip of hot coffee in a cold, snowy morning. It's like watching the sunset on the beach while on vacation. It never gets old. And we must continue to work the work of an evangelist as someone who shares the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. To share the word, to fulfill the ministry, and the ministry is not fulfilled until Jesus comes back. Our task as preachers, heralders of the word of God, is to not predict the response of those whom we proclaim it to, but it is to be faithful to the stewardship of the word of God that has the power to save and make all things new. And there are a few reasons why we don't share the gospel with people. We're scared of sharing the gospel because we're scared of being rejected. We don't want to say the incorrect thing while sharing the gospel. We don't care to share the gospel, or we don't even believe in the gospel ourselves. So do you know the word? Do you believe that the one true God, the maker of the heavens and the earth, came down to dwell among us? And that reason was to die on the cross to forgive us for our sins so that we may be with him in eternity. I hope you get to the opportunity to accept this truth. And if you haven't accepted this truth and want to know more, please come to us and we're more than happy to walk you through it. You can talk to Pastor John, to me, to the staff, to your small group leaders. We are here to help. And if you've been a Christian for 4 days, 4 months, 4 years, even 40 years, the mission is to preach the word, and that's it. It doesn't matter if you're biblically trained at Bible college or seminary. God uses ordinary men and women to preach the good news. And if you're not sure how to start, you can start by telling what Jesus has done in your life, how he has changed you from the person that you once were to the person that you are now. The woman at the well did that. And scripture says that many came to believe. If you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, your task is to steward what God has given you. That is why we keep enduring, suffering, and lasting. Because we need to preach God's word because it makes a difference in eternity. We need to preach God's word because it makes a difference in eternity. Romans 10:4. How then will they call on him who they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him whom they have not heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? As we start a new year together, one goal that we can embark on together is sharing the good news of the gospel. It doesn't have to be to a large crowd or multiple people. It can simply start by identifying one person in your life that needs to hear the gospel. I encourage you to write it down and pray for them. Pray that they would be receptive to the gospel when preached to them, but also to pray boldly that you are the one to preach the gospel to them. And I want to end with this, that it is a privilege to be used by God to bring people into his kingdom. It's a privilege. God has given us a gift, the word, the gospel, which is the power to save for all those who believe. We are to steward that gift. We are to preach the word no matter where we are and what we are facing. Let's all pray. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for this morning. Thank you for gathering us here to hear what you have in store for us today. Lord God, I pray for this new year that we would be bold, that we would be able to preach your word, because we know that preaching your word does not come back in void. And we know, Lord, that you have power to change anybody. And Lord, would you use us to be your vessels, to proclaim your truth to everyone. We thank you, Lord Jesus, and we lift this time up to you. In your name we pray.